As we journey through life, we all encounter ebbs and flows, many highs and lows. We often come across stumbling blocks that leave us feeling quite disheartened or unsure about how to move back to the realm of possibility and positivity. No matter what we undergo, we all can embrace the journey, tap into the tools to push through and overcome, and find the beauty in the ashes. This is Odyssey with Yendi, Beauty in the Ashes.
Make online purchases in a safe way with Debit MasterCard. Let the passion of football find you everywhere. MasterCard, start something priceless.
Brought to you in partnership with MasterCard and Sagicor.
Toni, it's so nice to see you in person and not in a little pip box on the screen.
Hi, nice to see you, Toni.
Good to see you. First things first, how is it that you ended up in that space where we see you on our screens all the time doing something that is so critically important to our society and our deaf community?
Well, I have to give the credit to my parents.
Yeah.
Both of my parents are deaf. I actually have three parents, my father, my mother, and my stepmother. They're all deaf.
Right.
So sign language started at home.
Yeah.
Got a little bit older, started working with the Jamaica Association for the Deaf. Then got exposed to Senator Floyd Morris. I don't know if you know him.
Mm-hmm.
And started working with him. He became the president of the Senate. And the rest is history. He told me that, hey, Parliament needs an interpreter. Deaf people need access. Told me to write a proposal. I did. And I've been on Parliament screen ever since.
Yeah. It's going how many years that you've been in that space?
Well, for Parliament, I've been in that space for going on 8 years, but professionally 15 years.
Amazing. Let's go back to where it all started. What is life like for a little girl who is growing up in a household where her parents are deaf? Because as far as you know, that's your normal world. Nothing is out of the norm for you, no?
I was just about to say that. I mean, I have nothing to compare it to.
Right.
So, one thing that I can say that it's a very fond memory of mine, I could turn up the music really loud.
Yes!
when my grandparents were not around.
Yeah.
There are some little things that you can do when your parents are deaf that I probably shouldn't share, but like when I'm mad with my father or my mother or my stepmother, I just wait till they turn their back and like, you know, and things like that. But, and trust me, sometimes they feel it and they do, you know, that they do like a quick
really?
Look back. Yeah. They're not hearing me, but
the energy. Yes.
Right. You know? So I mean, it was pretty normal.
Yeah.
The only thing that was different is that I use my hands and my eyes. So my hands to speak and my eyes to listen.
Mm-hmm.
I have grandparents who can hear. So it's not like I didn't have access to English or patois.
Right.
That was there. But my parents are the ones who are deaf. So I had no option, no choice. I just had to live with what I got. And I love them for it.
So was then your first language actually sign language?
Yes.
Yeah.
At 9 months old, I was crying. Mommy always tells the story. I was crying and my parents were in the bed sleeping. They locked the door. And grandparents banging on the door. My aunties banging on the door. I'm crying. I'm like, what's happening? That's what mommy said. All of a sudden, they felt something in the head. That's me throwing a bottle at 9 months old.
Wow. Signaling to them.
And I signed the milk. So at 9 months old, I was aware that my parents are deaf. It's just who they are. There's nothing wrong with it. It's just who they are.
Amazing. Amazing. You know what's amazing about that to me is I feel like sometimes because we operate within a particular world, being people who have language, communication in the form of speech,
mm-hmm.
You almost don't realize how resilient children are. And mm-hmm. you almost don't realize how adaptable children are. Can you remember what it was like for you when you first went to school and realized that, okay, there's another means of communication that's not just using my hands and signing?
So, definitely. So school was challenging for me.
Yeah.
I grew up in a visual world. I'm not much of a, well, not as a child, no I am. But as a child, I wasn't much of a reader. Hmm. I was more of a visual person. So I loved pictures. I loved being outdoors. I loved seeing things. I loved touching things. I was a feelsy, onsy, touchy, visual learner, yeah. Yeah. You know? And when you're placed into an hearing environment, that's what I would classify it as. That's not an option.
Right.
You have to be able to sit, listen, write, and do all those things to learn. And so because of that, it was difficult for me, you know, because that's when I realized, hey, my parents kind of impact me because I am now relying on things that I can't use in school.
Yes.
Things that can't help me in school, that won't, I won't be perceived as the brightest child.
Right.
I'll be perceived as, you're not learning anything, warm tea, and tough, you know?
Right.
And that is when I realized, no man, something different. And my friends, they would relay their experiences with their parents and how their parents could help them with homework and help them with things that my parents just couldn't do,
right?
Because they had no access to.
Right.
And so I learned that at an early age. I say about six, seven. I knew that I'm different.
Right. And was that okay with you, or did it bother you? Was it hard for you?
I mean, it was hard for me in the sense that I wanted to please my father.
Got you.
My father is a very, I love him to death. God knows. He's a very academic driven, very hands-on. He's an accountant, so you can just imagine. He's, oh, you need to know your book, you need to read, you need to, I'm like, daddy, you're not understanding, this is not me. And he would try to push me in a box that he considered success.
Got you.
He wanted me to be that doctor or that lawyer or that maybe a manager or somebody that he could say, hey, this I am deaf. This is my daughter, and this is what I produce.
Right.
Because I am deaf. And I watched him do a story time to the deaf community recently where he said he pushed me so hard because he wanted to prove that deaf people can. So I was a test run for him. So now I appreciate it, and I understand what he was trying to do.
Right, right.
You know, and I love him for it. I can't blame him for it.
Yeah. How does Toni then navigate traditional school? Because are you going to be one of those people that come and tell me your school motto, you're an immac girl, right?
Yeah.
I mean, is it by chance you're wearing light blue?
That's, it's not immaculate, right? Wearing light blue, but maybe.
But navigating the traditional school space, knowing that you didn't feel like you quite fit in that space.
Friends.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, even to this day, I mean, we call ourselves the lunch group. It's about 16 of us. We're not we're not close as in we see each other every day, but we have a WhatsApp group.
Yeah.
And we're so supportive of each other. It's amazing. I mean, when I was in school and I would tell them my stories, they would be like, they'll tell their stories and they just helped me to navigate, you know, go through school without worrying about, oh yeah, you're not, maybe you're not the brightest, but you're not the stupidest, right. You know. And my best friend, Sertina McGregor, Sertina Fuller now, she's married. And she was one of those people who, she really helped me to center myself and realize that school might not be for you. What you're in right now might not be for you, but you do have a purpose.
That part.
And trust me, we don't speak every day, but when we do speak, she reminds me. She said to me the other day that, remember when we, because we repeated fifth form together at Immaculate. They didn't accept us into sixth form. They said that we didn't qualify. And so we had to repeat. And she said, remember when you repeat and you were so worried and look at you now. You're in the history books.
Oh, you're going to make me cry.
And trust me, when she said it, I didn't even realize till she said it. And it just, you know, and friends, family, mommy, daddy, my brother, trust me, They're the reason why I am who I am.
Toni's too early. It's too early. Oh, man. But, you know, we just, you see and you don't know, you know, and people often see the end, but they don't understand the journey and the process to getting where people are, you know, and the heartache and the... So even as you said that, no, I guarantee there is someone who's watching this, there's a young girl who's watching this or a young boy who just had to repeat and feel like said them now nah, I'm out to nothing.
Right.
Who going to say, then she didn't have to repeat though.
Yeah.
Oh, but I'm all right.
Yeah, man.
Oh, look at her.
Yes, definitely. Oh, that was a humbling moment because I didn't fail my CXCs. Yeah. I wasn't ladylike enough, you know, the immaculate standard. Mm. I wasn't of a certain persuasion and my father could have easily put me in another sixth form, but he said, uh-uh. If immaculate say you're not ready, you're going to repeat. Mm. And so I repeated and it helped me. It really, you know, it gave me a sense of humility, you know, not to worry about where you're going, but to know that your path is already written for you. Mm. It's just for you to find it and follow it. Mm. I believe that everybody has a path.
Absolutely.
Nobody is here for no reason. Everybody has a reason why they're here.
Absolutely.
And they just have to find their path.
Absolutely. What happens after Immaculate? What's your path from there?
So after Immaculate, I did SATs. Mm-hmm. And then I went to Broward College in Florida. I was studying how to fly planes, how to be a pilot, because that was my dream.
Yeah.
And it didn't work out. My auntie stopped paying my school fee because she found out that I was gay,
okay.
You know, and she decided that she wasn't going to condone my lifestyle. And so she stopped paying my school fee, had to come back home, and that's where life started.
And that's when you said, "What, this is a skill set I have that could be actually an asset to many."
Right. Actually, my mom and my ex-partner was the one, and my friend Patrice Hobbs. Mm-hmm. She was like, "Why don't you sign? Why you don't go apply to the JAD?" And I was like, "Sure, I'll try." And I applied, got through. 9 to 5 wasn't my speed. Paperwork, report.
Yeah, I can gather that. It's not mine either.
Not my speed, and that was my job basically. Even though I was signing, 50. I would say 40% of the time signing, 60% of the time
paperwork.
It just wasn't my speed. So we didn't work out, left. I became a freelance interpreter and here I am today.
Okay, sounds like an absurd question, but I have to ask. Is signing different based on the spoken language of the space that you're in?
So not the spoken language, but the country.
Okay.
So Jamaica speaks Patois English, Pidgin, mixture of both. And we sign Jamaican Sign Language, which covers all of that.
Oh, I didn't realize it was specific.
It is.
Oh.
So America, American Sign Language, Japan, Japanese Sign Language, China, Chinese Sign Language, Canada, Canadian Sign Language. It's specific because language is influenced by culture. And so Jamaica, as much as we love to say we're English speakers, our culture
is Patois.
Right.
Right.
And so that influences our sign language. So I'll give you an example.
Yeah.
That body.
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh, you can sign that?
Yes, you can sign. Yeah. I saw that sign like.
Oh, wicked.
Or,
but hello is always hello, regardless of where you are.
Right. So hello.
Is thank you always thank you?
Well, it depends. Again, probably in America is thank you. Jamaica is thank you. Probably in Trinidad it's thank you. But maybe in China it's different.
Got you.
Because culture influences the language.
So I know thank you.
Yes.
And I know you're welcome.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it. Can you teach me something else? I want to know. I actually want to learn seriously how to say something in Patois. I didn't realize that we had that capability.
Yeah, so what would you like to learn?
I want to say, you don't know some man a bad man.
Yeah, what she said. So it's possible, you know. Language again is influenced by culture. So.
Amazing.
And if the prime minister is speaking English, and him switch, you I can do it. I switch.
Yeah.
If anybody, once they, as long as it's not a language that I don't understand, I'm good to go. Because.
Yeah.
We have some people who jump into Spanish and I might know a little Spanish, but I'm not versed. I'll be like,
got you.
But
I understand. Here is the MasterCard priceless moment. Let's talk a bit about Jamaica and how Jamaica responds to the deaf community and the disabled community at large. I still hear people use language like retarded. I still hear people use language that is insulting to people with disabilities. What can we do to shift that perception and that approach that people have towards the disabled community?
That's a heavy and loaded question.
Yeah.
I think the first thing is we have to start with schools. We always talk about teaching people certain things when they reach university, but it's not everybody goes to university.
And the impressionable years are gone.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So if we want kids, if we want the future to be more receptive of persons with disabilities or the deaf community, we have to teach kids what it is like to see a deaf person, how to sign, how to communicate with a deaf person. If you see somebody in a wheelchair, it's not abnormal. Some people are just in wheelchairs. If you see somebody who is unable to see, it's not abnormal. Some people are just not able to see. And so we have to start in the school. The government can legislate all they want, but legislation doesn't change attitude.
That's right.
Attitude change with parents, what your parents teaches you. Because if your parents say, no man, it's quite normal, you know, for deaf people to be around, that child will grow up into an adult and then repeat the same thing.
Right.
A long time to see deaf people. Nothing new.
That's right.
So it starts with your parents and schools.
Yeah.
And from we can fix that, we're good to go.
Mm-hmm.
We're good to go.
I agree. You know what else would be amazing? If sign language was actually offered outside of just a sign language club. So my suggestion, Toni, is how about Toni does a school tour where she goes around the island and teaches people basic communication in sign.
Funny you said that. Somebody contacted me to go with them on a school tour in May.
Yeah.
One of a radio personality, and she said, hey, would you mind coming with me to speak about your career to some students? I was like, I wanted to do that in 2020, but COVID
and then,
hit.
Yeah, yeah.
That was my plan in 2020 to go around to schools and talk about what it is like to be an interpreter and how you can get into the field and how to learn and all of that. But then COVID came. But definitely it's something on my to-do list, along with certification and training for sign language interpreters.
I want to do that.
Okay.
Oh, wait. I didn't hear the last part. No. I just want to learn. I don't know about them. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm not looking for nobody work. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. All right.
But
no problem.
I think it's amazing. I'm genuinely so intrigued and amazed at how humans are just so resilient. I'm honestly amazed by it every day. Every time I'm just like, then we really did come up with that. Yeah, we're good, you know? I live for it, you know? Let's talk a little bit about your national honor. I know that was huge for you. Walk me through it.
It's my first award. It's not mine. It's for an entire community, my deaf community. The day that I got the call that I was going to get the award, I was in shock because, a little side joke, OPM had owed me some money.
Right.
So when I saw the number coming, I'm like, you better be calling me about my check.
You better have my money.
So I picked up, I'm like, hello. She said, Miss Aiken, how are you? I'm like, I'm fine. I'm like, well, I'm just like to let you know that you've been conferred a national award in the Order of Distinction, you know. And I just went, I didn't even remember the money. Honestly, the money was like, psh. I was like, really? Thank you. I really appreciate it. I went, and I told my daddy, I told my brother, Abraham, I told my mom, I told everybody, I told my fiance, I told literally everybody. And for days, I was just in a place of happiness, you know. I felt appreciated. I felt like all this work, working, taking the bus, walking, hungry days, all of this, finally somebody realized that you're working, you're doing something. And again, I didn't do it for the award because it shot me.
Yeah.
I did it because I know that my mommy needs the access, my daddy needs the access, my stepmother needs the access, my deaf friends need the access, my deaf students, the kids, every deaf person who lives in Jamaica, not only Jamaica, you'll be surprised, Yendi. I get messages from people, America, Bulgaria, France. It's crazy. You're one of the best interpreters. I can't believe you're living in Jamaica. And I feel good because I know that all of that is not me. It's from a community. A community that I grew up in. A community that nurtured me, that taught me that, hey, this is us and this is you. And I love it. And if anything was happened to my hands, I don't know. I probably would die.
Better you're sure then.
Because this is my everything. And money or not, award or not, it's a sense of purpose and fulfillment. When I walk through a door, I'm a deaf kid, a kid, because my parents couldn't do that when they were kids. A kid can come up to me and say, I understand you. I watch the news. I feel good. Tell the prime minister. Them always giving me news to give the prime minister.
I love that.
But sometimes, most of the times the door reaches ears, but it's that feeling of being included.
Yes.
And not ostracized and isolated. You're now a part of society.
That part.
And you now can say, hey, I have a problem with this because somebody's there to facilitate your communication.
That's right.
And next 30 years from now, I want 100 more people like me.
Yeah.
Because you're going to need them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Trust me, we're going to have lawyers, doctors, politicians. I'm seeing it coming. You're going to need them.
What I also love and what's amazing to me is I can vividly remember as a child, it was not, you hardly encountered anyone with disabilities in terms of in everyday spaces. And what I love now, so there's a lady in our local supermarket who gave my daughter a signing sheet so she could learn sign language because she communicates via sign.
Right.
So she's deaf. And every time she sees her running to the supermarket or coming in, she's like, she comes and runs for her and she signs to her and she, you know, sees how much of the sign language she's learning. And I love that. I love that that's my daughter's experience because that wasn't my experience, you know. So the little bit I do know is because maybe at Deaf Can, I was taught how to say thank you when I ask for my tea, or, you know, the lady in the supermarket I'm referring to is sharing information with my daughter. And so I am now learning. So I agree with you that I think the future is going to look very differently. I think it's going to be much more integrated and people will be in all spaces and not just specifically spaces for disabilities or, you know, I love the integration. I love what I see happening. Yeah.
Yeah.
I look forward to it.
Yeah.
Where you go into a doctor's office.
Yeah.
And the receptionist
can sign.
Yes. And then we in turn are able to communicate. That's why I'm saying I would love for us all to learn sign language.
And we should all learn. We should all learn. That's why I say we need to start in school, because the effort we take in teaching Spanish and French, we should take the same effort in teaching sign language, so that Jamaican sign language, so that deaf Jamaicans can have access to their own Jamaican people.
Right.
Right now, a deaf person walks into PriceSmart, who is there to help? A deaf person goes to the hospital, who is there to help?
Right.
We need that to change. And the only way to change that is to start in school.
I'm signing up for a class.
All right.
So as soon as you're ready,
yes,
I'll be your first client, your first student.
Yes.
Where does Toni see herself 5 years from now?
Well, 5 years from now, I see myself with a fully fledged, I have an organization called Toni Terp. And so that organization is going to focus on sign language training certification, not only for Jamaica, but for the Caribbean and Latin America. So in the next 5 years, I expect that to be like hit the ground. It's already starting because we have started, we have registered our website, all of that. But I expect to have a cadre of students already graduated from that institution with certification and their level of skill as to where they are and where they can work. That's what I want to see. And of course, my chicken farm, me and my fiance's chicken farm taking over and beating Best Dress and Jamaica Broilers, because this 78,000 chicken thing not working. We need a 2 million, 3 million chicken farm.
That's right.
So that as well. Amazing. But I mean, 5 years, that's what I see myself. That's where I see myself.
Yeah. I would like for you to first maybe spend 5 minutes and we just teach some basics to people who are watching.
No problem.
So, hello, we all know.
Hello.
Right? Hello, we all know.
Yeah.
Goodbye is standard as well.
Mm-hmm.
I love you.
So there's an emoji on your phones now.
Oh, that's what it means.
This is what it means. Deaf people lobbied for this to be put on WhatsApp as an emoji.
Oh, that's so cool.
So this is I-L-Y.
Oh.
So I love you.
Wicked. Oh, I'm missing something. There we go.
It's actually the short version. So deaf people do this. But kids, or if you want to sign, you can say I
love
you.
You.
Or if you're talking to a whole heap of people, you.
For the collective.
Yeah, one person, you. Directional.
How do you say keep watching Odyssey with Yendi?
Okay. No problem. Keep.
Oh, I'm just going to watch you.
Okay. Odyssey with Yendi.
Oh, wait. How you say my name?
Spelling Y-E-N-D-D-I.
I.
Yendi.
Wicked.
So, in the deaf community, you would have name signs.
Right.
Unfortunately, I don't have a name sign for you yet, but I'm going to pressure them to make one for
you. It's not the most common, so, you know.
Yes,
but
yes.
Let me know.
You have Bolt.
Yes.
You have Shelly, you know.
So I know why this is Shelly.
Yes. And she used to train with a lot of deaf athletes. So
right.
She kind of can sign a little.
Right.
So they have a good relationship
Amazing.
With her. So Shelly. Yeah.
Well, let me know when you come up with it, because you know I'm going to be like...
Yeah, I'll let you know,
definitely. And more importantly, if you had one thing to say to a person who is watching, who still feels a little sheepish or awkward in approaching someone with a disability or in navigating that space, what would you say to them?
Just approach them. I mean, people are people.
Yes.
We are all diverse human beings. I love to say, if you cut me, you see red. If I cut you, I see red. Cut you, anybody. So just approach them. It's okay to be different. I mean, sometimes you might say something that might come off a little bit wrong. And if they correct you, accept it and say, I understand, and fix your language.
Right.
I mean, everybody wants to be included.
Right.
So just approach them and say, hey, start the conversation.
Ooh, I love that. Start the conversation. How do you say start the conversation?
Start. Conversation.
Conversation. Mm-hmm. I love that. How can I, let me see. Thank you.
Thank you.
For this conversation.
Yes, yes.
This
right.
conversation.
No, just thank you for the conversation.
Ah.
You were perfect.
I love this. Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
And keep doing what you're doing. It is remarkable. And it is necessary.
Thank you.
We appreciate you. You've changed the lens through which a lot of people view those with disabilities. And it's been amazing to watch.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm excited to see where it's going. I really am excited.
Yeah, me too.
I'm excited. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Brought to you by MasterCard and Sagicor. We'll be right back.
Make online purchases in a safe way with Debit MasterCard. Let the passion of football find you everywhere. MasterCard, start something priceless.